busy city of meetings. I try to interact with students whoever is interested in the causes that are dear to my heart and are very critical for Pakistan. And FATA is one of those areas where I really empathize with the people of FATA, and I also sympathize with the people of Pakistan for not being enough aware of what is FATA, how the people have suffered, are suffering. So this was a theme that we chose also for our advocacy campaign last year in connection with the FATA reform. This was a sequel to the 2011 reforms that President Zardari had decreed in August 2011, and we thought it was important to push for reforms as much as possible for the implementation of those recommendations. And we did about 20 TV programs involving about 100 parliamentarians as well as civil society members. And then we also additionally did 10 radio programs. This was just one project, and another project was about 60 programs concerning FATA, different dimensions of the life in FATA, the politics, the topography, the legal status. So in all, we ended up doing almost like 100 TV, radio programs, public consultations to push for reform in FATA. Now, I thought it will be good for the audience. I wish there were more students. This is a small, brief documentary about 8 to 9 minutes. We have it both in English and in Urdu, but I think here I have the version in Urdu. It's introducing FATA. So to your disadvantage, it's in, yeah. It's in Urdu. So we can actually play that. As it is done,
پاکستان تک 7 ایجنسیوں اور 6 ایف آرز پر مشتمل تقریباً 70 لاکھ کی آبادی اور 27,220 مربع کلومیٹر پر محیط پاک افغان سرحدی پٹی کو قبائلی علاقہ جات یا فاٹا کہا جاتا ہے. یہ علاقہ براہ راست وفاق کے زیر انتظام ہے, مگر یہاں نہ وفاقی قانون چلتا ہے نہ ہی کسی صوبے کا, بلکہ فاٹا میں جس قانون کے تحت فیصلے کیے جاتے ہیں انہیں فرنٹیئر کرائمز ریگولیشن یا مختصراً ایف سی آر کہا جاتا ہے. ایف سی آر کو سب سے پہلے 1893 میں انگریز حکمرانوں نے سرکش پختون قبائل کو کنٹرول کرنے کے لیے نافذ کیا تھا. انگریز حکمران تو 1947 میں ملک چھوڑ کر چلے گئے, مگر ان کا بنایا ہوا یہ جابرانہ قانون پاکستانی حکمرانوں کی عدم توجہی کی وجہ سے آج تک قبائلی عوام پر مسلط ہے. پاکستان کے سیاسی, عدالتی اور قانونی ماہرین اس بات پر متفق ہیں کہ 19ویں صدی کا یہ قانون موجودہ وقت کے تقاضوں سے قطعاً مطابقت نہیں رکھتا ہے, مگر اس کے باوجود نادیدہ قوتیں ایف سی آر کو فاٹا سے ہٹانے کی راہ میں رکاوٹ ہے.
یہ کہ تعلیمات پر اگر عمل نہیں ہوا تو اس میں ویسٹڈ انٹرسٹ موجود ہے, اور وہ ویسٹڈ انٹرسٹ جو ہے وہ بیوروکریسی کی شکل میں بھی ہے, وہ وہاں پر موجود دہشت گردوں کی شکل میں بھی ہے, اور وہ جو ہے جو قبل کرتے ہیں سرکاری فنڈز کو, جو ان ریڈیڈ فنڈ اسلام پر جاتے ہیں, وہ بھی اس کے اسٹیک ہولڈرز میں شامل ہے. اور ساتھ ہی ساتھ جو بین الاقوامی سیاسی صورتحال ہے, خصوصاً ہمارے نیبر ہوڈ میں افغانستان میں, یہ بھی اس کی ایک کنٹریبیوٹری فیکٹر ہے.
ایف سی آر سب سے پہلے 1901 میں فاٹا کے ساتھ ساتھ صوبہ سرحد اور بلوچستان میں بھی نافذ کیا گیا, اور اس کی دفعہ 4 میں واضح طور پر درج ہے کہ اس کے بعد سخت دفعات جیسے دفعہ 6 سے 19 اور 38 سے 51 تک صرف سرحدی اضلاع کے پختون اور بلوچ عوام کے خلاف استعمال کیے جائیں گے. وقت گزرنے اور عوام میں اس کالے قانون کے خلاف شعور بیدار ہونے کے بعد یہ جابرانہ قانون صوبہ سرحد اور بلوچستان سے واپس اٹھایا گیا. मगर 113 साल गुजरने के बावजूद कबायली आवाम आज भी इस जालिमाना कानून के शिकंजे में जकड़े हुए हैं। वो कानून जिसमें 1997 तक आम आदमी को वोट डालने का हक तक हासिल नहीं था, वो कानून जिसके जेर इंतजाम तकरीबन 70 लाख की आबादी वाले इस कबायली खत्ते में आज भी जज या मुंसिफ नाम का कोई ओहदा नहीं।
नया नोटिफिकेशन जारी किया है अभी जो कमेटी, ये तो अभी वाजिह नहीं किया गया है कि ये रिफॉर्म्स किस हवाले से होंगे, लेकिन इसमें ये बात है कि ये रिफॉर्म 20-25 साल के लिए होंगे। तो इससे ये बात साबित हो सकती है कि जो हालात अभी फाटा में है, जो मुश्किलात है, जो दहशतगर्दी के वार वहां पर चल रही है, तो इसका मतलब तो ये है कि मतलब कि ये सिलसिला जो है ये आइंदा 20-25 साल के लिए जारी रहेगा। और दूसरी बात यह है कि इस रिफॉर्म में न तो आर्टिकल 247 की बात है, न पार्लियामेंट में अमेंडमेंट की बात है, न हाई कोर्ट और सुप्रीम कोर्ट के एक्सटेंशन की बात है, न जुडिशरी और एग्जीक्यूटिव के सेपरेशन की बात है, न ह्यूमन राइट्स और फंडामेंटल राइट्स की एक्सटेंशन और इम्प्लीमेंटेशन की बात है।
सियासी शऊर और तहरीर तकरीर की आजादी दौरे हाजिर में मायारी जिंदगी के पैमाने समझे जाते हैं, मगर बदकिस्मती से पाकिस्तान का ये कबायली इलाका ग्लोबल विलेज के इस दौर में भी इन आजादियों का मुस्तहिक नहीं समझा जा रहा है। यही वजह है कि सियासी आजादी के बावजूद फाटा तक पेमरा आर्डिनेंस को तौसी नहीं की जा रही। नतीजतन आज भी यहाँ रिसाला, अखबार या रेडियो चलाने पर पाबंदी है और यहाँ के सहाफी भी गुनागू मुश्किलात से दोचार है।
उनके लिए जो बुनियादी जरूरत है वो इंफॉर्मेशन तक रसाई है, जो कि फाटा में बिल्कुल भी नहीं है। मैं ये कहूंगा कि वहां पे ऐसे इलाके हैं कि वहां पे जो मकामी लोग हैं वो नहीं जा सकते हैं, तो जो सहाफी हैं उनको तो बिल्कुल भी वहां पे इजाजत नहीं है। और फिर वहां पे जो कानून है फ्रंटियर टर्म्स रेगुलेशन वो जो है उसको उसमें भी ऐसे शिक है जिसके नीचे जो है फाटा के सहाफियों पर पाबंदियां हैं।
आजादी इजहार है वो उसकी गारंटी आईन देता है और आईन एक इमरानी वादा है शहरियों के और रियासत के दरमियान। कबायली इलाकों को आईन की जुरिस्डिक्शन से बाहर रखा गया है और ये जो दफा इसको बाहर करती है उससे वो 246 और 247 है, और जब तक इसमें तरमीम नहीं होगी आजादी इजहार जो हमें हासिल है सेटल्ड इलाकों में उसकी तौसी मुमकिन ही नहीं है कि वो कबायली इलाकों तक की जा सके।
कबायली आवाम का कहना है कि फाटा के लिए अलग सेक्रेटरियट के क्याम ने उनको मजीद तन्हा और अलग करके रख दिया है, क्योंकि सूबों और अजला में न सिर्फ ये कि अदलिया वो इंतजामिया एक दूसरे से अलग और बाइख्तियार है, बल्कि बाकी तमाम महकमों के जिली अफसरान भी अपने अख्तियारात के मालिक और सिर्फ अपने अफसरान बाला को जवाबदेह होते हैं। मगर बदकिस्मती से फाटा के तमाम एजेंसियों में इख्तियारात का मरकज व मंबा सिर्फ पॉलिटिकल एजेंट होता है, जो न सिर्फ जिला के मुंतजिम आला बल्कि मुंसिफ आला के इख्तियारात भी इस्तेमाल करता है। इस तर्ज अमल से बाकी अफसरान उसमें मुअत्तल बनकर रह गए हैं।
एक पॉलिटिकल एजेंट के पास इस दफा 33 डिपार्टमेंट है जो इस्तेमाल कर रहे हैं। अगर ये लोकल गवर्नमेंट बा इख्तियार बना दिया जाए और एक डिपार्टमेंट के इख्तियार लोकल कोर्सल या लोकल उसमें इस्तेमाल तकसीम किया जाए तो मेरे ख्याल में ये फाटा बहुत तरक्की कर सकता है।
अगरचे साबिक सदर आसिफ अली जरदारी ने अगस्त 2011 में एफसीआर में कुछ तरामीम की मंजूरी दी जिसमें सियासी आजादी के अलावा इज्तिमाई जिम्मेदारी को महदूद करना, बच्चों और उम्र रसीदा अफराद को गिरफ्तार न करना और फाटा ट्रिब्यूनल का क्याम भी शामिल है, मगर अफसोस है कि इन तरामीम पर अमल दरामद न होने के बराबर है। इज्तिमाई जिम्मेदारी के तहत बेतहाशा गिरफ्तारियां आज भी रोज का मामूल है।
मैं पेशावर से जनूबी वजीरिस्तान जा रहा था, जब टांग पहुंचा तो वहां पर खासेदार खड़े थे, उन्होंने मेरा गाड़ी रोका, मुझसे पूछा कि आपका शनाख्ती कार्ड है। मैंने कहा जी मेरा शनाख्ती कार्ड चेक किया, कहते यार ये आपके कौम का लोग जो है ना इसको तो आम करते हैं ना। तो मैंने कहा जो जिसने कुछ किया होगा उनको जरूर पकड़े ना, हम तो पेशावर से तकरीबन 10-12 साल के बाद आ रहे हैं, ना मुझे वहां का कौम का पता है ना और किसी चीज का पता है। तो उन्होंने ये 2 दिन मुझे वहां पर रख लिया, पोलिटिकल एजेंट का कहते आर्डर है।
मिसाइल थे वो ज्यादा, पानी नहीं था, बिजली नहीं था, उसके खिलाफ हमने जुलूस निकाला, एहतजाज कर रहा था, हुकूमत ने एहतजाज को नहीं छोड़ता था, उसमें हमारा हुकूमत का हाथ पटाई भी हुई। तो उस दौरान मुझे पकड़ लिया, मेरे साथ और कुछ लोग भी था, उसने पकड़ लिया और शाम तक गले में जेल में रखा, कहीं कबूल जेल में लाया और सुबह सवेरे अजान से पहले
कबायली आवाम के साथ अब फाटा की 10 सियासी जमातों ने भी इत्तेहाद कायम करके फाटा में इस्लाहात के लिए अपनी कोशिशें तेज कर दी हैं। इस इत्तेहाद के तीन बड़े मुतालबात ये है कि आईन की दफा 247 में तरमीम की जाए ताकि आला अदलिया और पार्लियामेंट के इख्तियार को फाटा तक बढ़ाया जा सके। फाटा के अंदर अदलिया को इंतजामिया से अलग किया जाए और फाटा में भी बल्दियाती इंतखाबात के जरिए आवाम को बाइख्तियार बनाया जाए।
कि सबसे पहले इन्हीं 10 जमातों ने पहले फाटा में पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज ऑर्डर के हवाले से कंसेंसस पैदा किया और पूरे मुल्क में चारों सूबों में अपनी मीटिंग्स की, यहाँ तक के प्रेसिडेंट उस वक्त जरदारी साहब के साथ मुलाकात की और फिर वो 2011 में फिर उन्होंने वो एग्रीमेंट साइन किया तरमीम। तो हमारी सबसे पहली डिमांड तो ये है कि वो चार प्रेसिडेंट की जो है वो पार्लियामेंट को मुंतकिल किए जाए ताकि वो अपने इलाके के मसाइल उस हालात के मुताबिक वो कानून साजी करे।
बाद दूसरी गैर सरकारी तंजीमों की तरह सीआरएसएस भी गुज़िश्ता कई साल से फाटा में इस्लाहात के लिए कबायली अवाम के शाना बशाना जिद्दोजहद में मसरूफ है। अपने रेडियो और टीवी प्रोग्राम्स के साथ साथ सेमिनार और डायलॉग्स के जरिए भी न सिर्फ फाटा के मसाइल उजागर कर रही है बल्कि यहाँ के आवाम की आवाज को हुक्मरानों तक पहुँचाने का वसीला भी बन गई है। हम उम्मीद है कि हमारी कोशिशें बहुत जल्द मुस्बत तब्दीली का पेश खेमा साबित होगी। शम्स मोमन, सीआरएसएस, इस्लामाबाद।
शम्स मोमन, वन ऑफ आवर कॉलीग्स, ही रेड आउट द नरेशन, तो जानबूझ के हमने किया था। आपको उर्दू शायद थोड़ी सी लगी होगी, टेढ़ी मेढ़ी है, पर वो हमने जानबूझ के किया कि मोहम्मद एजेंसी से ताल्लुक रखने वाले हमारे साथी हैं, उन्होंने अपने दर्द को सो कॉल्ड या इस अंदाज में मतलब रिफॉर्म के लिए के हवाले से डॉक्यूमेंट्री की शुरू इन्होंने लिखा, उसको हमें फॉलो कर रहे थे जो कुछ हम कर रहे हैं। सो द आइडिया वाज टू हैव अ नेटिव लोकल। आपने ये देखी, आप में से किसको इसमें से क्या चीज याद रही है डॉक्यूमेंट्री में से? ओके, और
द नेग्लिजेंस ऑफ मीडिया
आर्टिकल 247।
या व्हाट इज लाइक फंडामेंटली व्हाट डू यू रिमेंबर आर्टिकल 247? ओके,
द रिफॉर्म्स इंट्रोड्यूस्ड बाय द जरदारी गवर्नमेंट।
ठीक है, so what is the fundamental structure of that is that governs FATA?
FATA
se kaun taluk, aapne se hai ki FATA se you are from FATA?
Yeah.
So you are this
it's just problem.
Okay, so you are the exception.
Yeah.
Okay, good. This means के वो जो documentary है फिर अच्छी नहीं थी, मतलब इसको we have to redo it. Like ये documentary failed in conveying what we wanted to convey. This I must admit. So what we will do, I'll quickly run through like what is the foundation for FATA, the constitutional foundation. Then I think we can go to list down some of the sections that are part of the FCR, the Frontier Crimes Regulation, and then see whether it is in sync with the Article 25 of the Pakistani Constitution. Article 25 is about the equal citizenry, equal rights for every citizen. So this is how, let's quickly go through this PowerPoint presentation. This is a former governor, Ali Jan Aurangzeb, journal, and I was interviewing him and he said, yeah, we have treated tribal people like caged monkeys for decades. We are responsible for their plight today. This was 3-4 years ago. Now, what is FATA? Because nobody knows about it, so I thought let's start with the fundamentals.
that's 27,200 square kilometer challenging mountainous and hilly terrain. It's divided into 7 agencies, and the population, according to 1998 census, was 3.5 million, which may have grown beyond 1 million right now. And the border, the Pakistan border with Afghanistan, on 1,200 kilometers. The basic indicators that you have poverty, you have the lack of education, heavy unemployment, there's basically no industry, major tribes. Ye yaad rakhne wali baat hai. We have four major tribes, Afridis, Khyber Agency, and a couple of in the frontier region, and then Momans, and then Waziris. And then there are many sub-tribes. You can see here, that in Bajawar you have the Glani and Uthman Khail, then in North Waziristan this is Uthmanzai Waziris and Dawards. In South Waziristan, Amazai Waziris and Masuds. And as I said, Khyber is Afridi and Shimrari. Kurram is Turi, Bangish. Mohmand is Mohmand and Safi. You know Salim Safi, the famous anchor. He also comes from the same region. Then Orakzai, they are basically Orakzai. So this is the smallest of 7 agencies. And it has no border with Afghanistan. It's just next to Peshawar. So in Pakistani constitution, the Article 246 basically says that these regions are part of Pakistan. And then under Article 247, that was talked about, this documentary mein bhi zikr hua tha, usme koi ikhtiyarat tamam tar jo FATA se mutalliq hai, wo sadr Pakistan ko hasil hai. To bunyadi taur pe sadr Pakistan, the president of Pakistan, is the chief commander, chief in charge of FATA. Under the Article 247, appointments, legislation, administrative measures are basically the responsibility of the president, and the president has his agent in that region, that is the governor of the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, and governor then appoints FATA agencies have one political agent each. Then the governor and the political agent, they rule through the Frontier Crimes Regulation, which the British had left, enacted in 1901. And it's a two-tiered system. One is the political agent, who represents the federal government, the president of Pakistan, in FATA. And then the Maliks. Maliks are basically title holders. It's a title that is ancestral, mostly. It's given by the political agent to the head of a tribe or head of a family. So in 2010, I think, we had about 35,000 registered Maliks within FATA. And Malik is a basically link between the government and their respective tribes. Am I right? No. He's the intermediary.
There are such complications as
well. I know, but don't complicate those things here, you know. But we are talking of a theoretical framework, yeah, which governs FATA. So we have the president. The president is represented by the governor. The governor is represented by the political agent. From the government side, from the tribal side, it's the Malik, the title holder. The FCR, if you see, it canonizes the concept of collective responsibility. This is, what is that section, do you remember? The collective responsibility?
No, you don't remember. So that was the intention of showing those interviews at the end of the documentary. You remember when these guys were talking about they were held up, कि उनको रोका गया, वो काले background के साथ जो दो-तीन interviews थे, बहुत सारे लोगों को political agent के order के तहत पकड़ लिया जाता है। कहते जी हमने section 40 के तहत आपको पकड़ लिया। उसको बताते नहीं हैं। आपको जो political agent ने, assistant political officer ने कहा कि उनको गिरफ्तार करें, गिरफ्तार के लिए बंद कर दिया। वो गिरफ्तारी 9 साल भी हो सकती है, 9 दिन भी हो सकती है, 90 दिन भी हो सकती है। उसको जरूरत ही नहीं है एक्सप्लेनेशन देने की क्या उसको क्यों पकड़ा गया। तो ये हमने केस स्टडीज की। वी हैड पीपल फ्रॉम डिफरेंट एरियाज ऑफ आगरा इंटरव्यूड देम। 99% ऑफ देम सेड दैट दे वर डिटेन्ड फॉर अ वीक और टू डेज और अ मंथ विदाउट नोइंग व्हाट वाज देयर क्राइम एंड अंडर व्हाट सेक्शन वर दे डिटेन्ड। So this is the level of ignorance even among the people who are being governed by the Frontier Crimes Regulation. They don't know under what law, under what section of the FCR are they detained or punished. So that means it's a very draconian law, the FCR. I know people who were detained under that law and who passed away. One of the persons who was detained together with us when we were visiting Waziristan for political rallies with a camera. So he was detained and he died. He had a heart attack and nobody knew, you know. His family also never knew why was he detained. The most apparent samne nazar aane wala jo jurm tha wo ye tha ke jo siyasi jalse mein unhone shirkat ki thi. Jab tehreek e nifaz e shariat e mohammadi ki tehreek chal rahi thi 1995-96 में उस वक्त। सो इट्स अ वेरी स्क्यूड वेरी ड्रेकोनियन लॉ। उसमें आई कैन कोट यू सम एग्जांपल्स। फॉर इंस्टेंस द पॉलिटिकल एजेंट यू नो कैन ही इज बेसिकली द अनक्राउन्ड किंग इन फाटा। सो ही कैन से दैट आई डोंट लाइक दिस पर्सन, he has committed crime. So his authorities, his subordinates will go, they can arrest that person, they can demolish his house, saying that we suspect there are terrorists inside. Or the political agent can say under the FCR 14 that a crime has been committed in your area, you are responsible for this. And that means 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 houses can be demolished. Just because the political agent or his deputies say there are terrorists inside or there are criminals inside. So the FCR 40 is the most commonly abused section of the Frontier Crimes Regulation. The Frontier Crimes Regulation originally comprised about 62 sections. Then there were revisions made to it before this 2011 amendments to the FCR, and it has now come down to about 49 or 50 sections. There is practically, you cannot participate in any political activity under the FCR. You cannot have a party, you cannot have a gathering, unless you have the permission of the political agent who says you can hold a jirga here. And jirga also has to be connected with a governmental concern. That the government says, there's a problem, we are looking for terrorists, we are looking for criminals, you have to hand over those terrorists to us. So then people get together for a jirga, decide whether the guy is there or not, and whether they can arrest him and hand over to the authorities. Now, the Article 247 of Pakistan's constitution says that no act of parliament shall apply to FATA unless the president directs. So, neither the Supreme Court nor a high court shall act. So basically, you're excluding, or the FCR and the Article 247, they exclude FATA from the fundamental human rights, which are part of the Constitution of Pakistan, from Article 8 to Article 28 of Pakistan's Constitution, you have different rights guaranteed. And those rights include basically right to expression, right to assembly, right to education. Right to education is now a fundamental right in Article 25A, I think. So that's why the pressure has been there. There has been consistent demands by Fatah people ki ji hame FCR se nijat dilaye. FCR se nijat jo Tehreek-e-Nifaz-e-Shariat-e-Muhammadi thi jo emerged late 1994 mein, uski bunyadi wajah bhi FCR thi ya denial of fundamental human rights. Isliye ke wo humne Maulana Sufi Muhammad ke saath travel kiya from the north, like from Bajawar to south Waziristan in late 1995 to cover different rallies. And we were interviewing different people on the way as we were moving with the people of Maulana Sufi Muhammad. So I would ask people, why do you want Sharia? You know, because they were saying, we want Sharia, we want Sharia. Why do you want Sharia? Kehte ji, hame insaaf chahiye. We want justice. So I would ask that Sharia will give you justice. They said yes. That's what we believe. So imagine this craving for justice, craving for fundamental rights, at that time translated into a demand for Islamic Sharia. So this also explains what happened in Iran in 1979 and before that, the Iranian Revolution, that there was denial of fundamental rights, there was this dictatorship, and most of Iran just turned the Khomeini way, just because they thought maybe this provides us the relief, this provides, gives, paves the way for our fundamental rights. So you can easily trace this turnaround, this push for militancy or accommodation for militancy inside Fatah to the non-existence of fundamental rights. And there's a long history, you know, because I've been traveling and covering Fatah since like 1988-89. And every time we got there, we heard ke ji hame to insaan hi nahi samjha jata. And then I met with the governor, the then governor of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, uswak tabhi still it was Northwestern Frontier Province, must have been early 2010, when the governor said, we have treated Fatah people like caged monkeys for decades, and we need to relieve them of this. The only way for that is, of course, fundamental human rights. But in the presence of the FCR, you don't have fundamental rights. Women, for instance, women don't exist in FCR except when it comes to giving a woman jo naan nafka kehte hain, pata nahi angrezi mein usko kya kehte hain, to wo jab PC ke saath agar zyadti khatoon ke saath ho jaye usko aapne kya dene, baki iske alawa usme koi rights nahi hai usme. Jaise Pakistan Penal Code mein there's a section 498A. Uske tehat, by law, you cannot deprive women, Pakistani citizens, of their due share in property. And you cannot violate that. If you violate that, uski kam az kam saza 7 saal hai. 1 lakh rupaye jurmana bhi hai. 498D, Pakistan Penal Code. Ye kehte ki zabardasti ki shaadi aap nahi karwa sakte. Baqaida kanoon mein, kanoonan paband hai har shahri ke wo zabardasti बेटी की या बहन की शादी नहीं करवाएगा. सजा उसकी फिर कम से कम 3 साल है अगर ये साबित हो जाए कोर्ट में कि जबरदस्ती शादी करवाई गई है. एफसीआर में इस किस्म की कोई चीज मौजूद नहीं है, यानी खवातीन बेसिकली फीमेल वुमेन डोंट एग्जिस्ट इन दैट सोसाइटी एज पर द एफसीआर. देन
So if we then move forward, do you really want this? These are some of the organizations which have been operating in Fatah. Tehreek Taliban Pakistan, everybody knows. Then Lashkar-e-Islam is mostly, it is located in the Khyber Agency. Ansar al-Islam is also located in the Khyber Agency. Then Tehreek-e-Nifaz-e-Shariat-e-Muhammadi, this was located in Bajor and parts of Swat. Then TTP, Jamaat-ul-Ahrar, this is a splinter group that emerged last year. These organizations based in Fatah have been hosting people from outside Fatah, outside Pakistan. And we have a number of organizations which were being hosted, and they were like Jaish-e-Muhammad or their splinter groups, then Harkatul Mujahideen, this Maulana Fazlur Rahman Khalid's organization, Lashkar-e-Jangvi, and also splinter groups of Lashkar-e-Taiba. So, and the media management of most of the groups was being done by Punjabi Taliban. You know, you must have heard a lot about Punjabi Taliban, because they were educated. They came from Murid K and from Bahawalpur and from Jang, and relatively educated. And that's why a number of people who have been killed, who went on to become Al-Qaeda activists inside Waziristan particularly, they were mostly like 99% Punjabis. What else should I say on this? Because this is not about militancy. Let me see. So I think I'll stop this PowerPoint here. I can straight away go back to a Peshawar High Court judgment. Last April, the Peshawar High Court came out with a pretty damning indictment of the state of Pakistan, I can say, because somebody had challenged the FCR in the Peshawar High Court, and then they came out with a very relevant ruling, which was in consonance with the 2011 recommendations and the amendments to the FCR. And a group of lawyers then also analyzed that ruling, and it basically advised the government to extend the jurisdiction of the High Court and the Supreme Court to Fatah by an act of parliament and or an amendment of the constitution. The Peshawar High Court also said that appeal against the judgment or reconstitution of the Fatah tribunal should be done in such a way that it would no longer be an extension of the executive. So the Peshawar High Court then said that the executive and the judiciary must be separated, because right now the political agent is the judge and the jury, and the administrator and the executive is everything. So basically he can ruin anybody's life if he wants. And then they made some recommendations as well. The judgment also basically initially said that the reform process for Fatah has been inadequate to date. The legal vacuum carried by lack of further reform is leading not only to the grave violation of fundamental rights of the residents of Fatah, but also plays a role in destabilizing other parts of the country. This is what we have been hearing, that Fatah is a source of destabilization of the rest of the country. Nobody speaks about the Punjab. Punjab is the headquarter of the sectarian, of the militant organizations, whether it's the Murid K or whether it's Jang or whether it's Bahawalpur. As I said a few minutes ago, that Punjab has been providing the leadership in media management to Fatah. But yes, of course, this is a reality that a lot of people, groups, entities based in Fatah have been the source of destabilization, not only of Pakistan, but also abroad. Look, I mean, what
John Kerry said during his visit about 10 days ago, no, about a week ago, he mentioned Lashkar-e-Taiba, he mentioned the Haqqani network, and he has been saying this for the past 7 years, actually. This is the most surprising thing. You pick up John Kerry's statements when he comes here, when he was in India last year. His statement reads more or less the same. Kiji Lashkar-e-Taiba, Haqqani network, and all related terrorist networks based in Fatah must be eliminated, must be taken off. So this is what the Peshawar High Court also alluded to. Then it basically, in view of the Peshawar High Court, which basically created a huge space for advocacy and possibly for more reform and possibly for the abolition of the FCR as such, because right now Fatah is neither here nor there. Constitutionally, if you look at the constitution, it is just a strip, 27,200 square kilometers. People live there, but they don't enjoy rights. So some of the recommendations that the civil society has made basically say that conducting in-depth research to demystify the Rivaj. Rivaj, again, maybe you can explain afterwards. It relates to the tradition. There has been the tradition of independence of the tribe, in cultural, this a unique culture in Fatah. Somehow we need a new debate on this. What is sacrosanct? The constitution of Pakistan or the Rivaj? Of course, Rivaj relates to culture, it should be respected. But if you take cover of the Rivaj, saying that, you know, a criminal takes shelter at your place, or you provide shelter to a criminal, to a murderer, you can't say that Rivaj dictates that I provide shelter to this person. He's a fugitive from law, so it has to be dealt with accordingly. So for that, we need a detailed discussion within Pakistan, within Fatah itself, that somehow, and I think that will only come when you remove the special status of Fatah, to give people the confidence that they are equal citizens and that they can go to a court, to the Supreme Court, to the High Court, whenever they have a grievance. Another recommendation was to explore the nature of the agreement of the tribal elders with the state of Pakistan. It relates to 1947 when tribal elders decided to join Pakistan voluntarily. And then in return, they said, don't touch our areas. You know, let Fatah remain as it is. But does this mean that we allow a state within state where murderers, criminals, drug runners have a free run and you can't touch them? Because I think one feature I should explain, Fatah, basically, all the laws under the FCR, they apply only to the main road that is running through that particular agency, and 50 feet both sides. Beyond that, then the Malik is supposed to enforce the FCR. So basically, the army can, of course, go there. But then if the army goes directly, that means it's violating the Rivaj. So it's quite a complicated issue. Then the one recommendation was, as what we are doing, and I hope that ye jo message hai aap log bahar bhi leke jayenge, keep hammering on raising pressure for the reform of FCR. It has to be humanized, it has to be made more constitutional, more fundamental human rights based. And then there was another demand and a recommendation for extending the local government to empower the people. My personal view on Fatah for the way forward is the president has the authority to do something. And actually, I can read that out. It's very much here in the papers, within the powers of the president. Section 6 of the Article 247 says, the president may at any time, by order, direct that the whole or any part of a tribal area shall cease to be tribal area and
such order may contain such incidental and consequential provisions as appear to the President to be necessary and proper. Now, people have been demanding, the parliamentarians also who have been part of this FATA reforms process, that the President also hand over his legislative authority on FATA to the Parliament, so that Parliament can legislate about FATA. You know, we have 12 members of Parliament from FATA in this National Assembly, 8 in the Senate. But the irony is, they cannot talk about FATA. Their vote is only good for formation of the government, for critical issues when the government wants to get 2/3 majority, or vote of confidence or no confidence. The rest, they are good for nothing. Yes, whenever these 20 guys come into the parliament, they become richer. Why? Because the ruling party provides them funds in return for support. So almost in every instance this has happened. So basically, the FATA MNAs and senators, 20, they are there to serve the mainstream parties, the ruling elites of Pakistan. They have no other role as such. And that's why our take is, first, remove this special status of FATA. The President can do it. You know, they can do a lot of things through ordinances. If they can issue ordinances on Pakistan Protection Act or Pakistan Protection Ordinance, or they can issue ordinances on the local government, why can't they do it on FATA? Particularly when all FATA people hold national ID cards, they hold a Pakistani passport. So why not extend the law of the land to FATA? And then also with that, I think the fundamental rights as desired or as directed by the Peshawar High Court can also be extended. Political Parties Act is already extended, but still there are limitations in doing politics inside FATA. So I think with this I will end saying that the FATA region is an aberration. Aberration ka pata nahi Urdu mein kya, mujhe nahi pata. Yeah, it's an aberration that needs to go, and for that the civil society, academia, the media need to really press hard and keep demanding that the President give away his powers under Article 247 to the Parliament, so that Parliament can legislate and help in extending the law of the land, the basic rights to FATA. And therein lies the future for Pakistan. And because we are talking about the way forward is mainstreaming FATA, extending the rule of law, the law of the land there, empowering the people through the local government. Only then can we expect loyalty, sympathy, empathy from the people of FATA. I think with this I'll end here, and then if you have any questions, go ahead.
Listening to you, what I find strange is that Pakistan presumably has signed a number of the international conventions and so on civil liberty, on human rights, and so on and so on. And how you can possibly have a situation where you have Pakistani citizens with passports and identity numbers who are deprived not just of rights under your constitution, but are deprived of rights under international law. You know, it just strikes me as a very unique situation that should be changed or abolished.
Yeah, you're right. Everybody, whereas the political agent cannot be, even cannot afford to be high-handed with everybody. However, when you displease him,
when he is unhappy or when he is under pressure by the government, then he can be very, very brutal, more brutal than the Israelis are with the people in Gaza or in Ramallah. Yes, the analogy is correct to a certain extent. Yeah. And yeah, this is precisely the point that under the FCR, you don't allow them the rights, they can't go to any court. If at all, they go end up in the Fatah tribunal, which was constituted as a result of the 2011 amendments. But the issue is, it's only bureaucrats who are sitting at the Fatah tribunal. That's number one. Number two, the decision of the Fatah tribunal is not binding on the political agent. So he can turn it down. So you are right in that sense that they are totally at the mercy of the political agent. However, then there are groups like these Maliks and whoever is towing the line of the government, who is in command respect, you know, people, then political agent can't be that high-handed with them. But theoretically, yes, it is an aberration. It must end because it does not guarantee, it does not provide fundamental rights to the people living there.
You mentioned Tehreek-e-Nefaz-e-Shariat-e-Muhammadi rallies in Waziristan in 1994 and 95. And you said that the people were looking up, were asking for Sharia in return for the tribal FCR system. Actually, what important to me is, like, your audience, who are your target? Like, if we look to the Sufi Muhammad, the followers of him are mostly religious-minded people. And in tribal area, I think the people are most liberal in their minds. Like, throughout history, if you look to their history, they never demanded Sharia. This was the wave, particular wave, that was coming down from 1978 and was just entered into the Taliban period. And then secondly, like you say that the people of Fatah, they are providing shelter to the extremists. I think the people of Fatah have no powers in real to protect people. It is the government, the incompetence of the government. Why they are not securing our border with Afghanistan? Like, we do not want infiltration in such a form. And our economic front, headquarters is never Afghanistan, or was never Kabul. But Peshawar and Punjab, it was the economic headquarter of the whole of Afghanistan and even the tribal people, of the people of Fatah. And thirdly, you said that the elders are above the law of Pakistan. No, I think whenever Fatah was run, it was through agreements. Like, agreements were signed with the tribal elders through jergas. But what we see is the lack of agreements when Pakistan came into being. Like, we see no agreements with the people of Fatah. But the British rule Fatah through agreements. Like, if you go through the history of the British period, of the British rule, you will find lots of agreements with the tribal people. So these are few of the comments. Your presentation, like you highlighted Fatah, it was really wonderful. But now people of Fatah, especially educated people, they are looking beyond reforms. They want the extension of the constitution of Pakistan to the tribal territory. They are not looking for reforms anymore. Like, I do not want to be ruled by a king. I do not want to be ruled by a president. Like, My Majesty is President Mamnoon Hussein. The people of Fatah are not looking for majesties. So they are looking for public representatives. Thank you so much.
Yeah, that's what I'm, you can't have two states within a state. And it's all about fundamental rights. Everybody, as I said, you know, everybody who possesses a document, Pakistani travel and or ID document, must be treated equally. And regardless whether he or she is Muslim or non-Muslim, you know, we should all press for Article 25, which promises equal citizenry rights to everybody living in Pakistan. This is so close to my heart because I've lived for some time in Europe, I've been visiting. So wherever I go, I see if the Article 25 could be applied and could be adhered to,
it could also help in not only mainstreaming Fatah, it could also help in ensuring getting like social peace and harmony within the society, because according to our constitution, only a Muslim can be the president or the prime minister, which I personally think is very discriminatory. Anybody who's a citizen of Pakistan must have the right to go as high as the president or the prime minister of Pakistan. So that's why, I mean, without going into the debate whether it's an Islamic state or un-Islamic state, we should not go into that. We should use the constitution of Pakistan as our base document, as a reference. And the Article 25 must be treated as a priority article, because in the eyes, in the light of the Article 25, everybody is an equal citizen. Now, Waziristan, look, you know, there are certain realities which even people in Fatah did not admit. I've been going to Waziristan. First time I went there in 2003, then I went in 2004, then 2004 I went twice. I went on my own, not embedded with the army. And I went to South Waziristan as well as North Waziristan. My hosts had foreign guests, right? Because they were paying money. They were the paying guests. They were Arabs, Uzbeks, and my host, one of the journalists, he said, you know, we were sort of unlucky. I said, why? Because we got Uzbek guests. They don't have much money, whereas the Arabs have a lot of money. So this was a reality that a lot of people in Waziristan denied for a long time. Many of them deny this even today. But trust me, where I was living, spending nights next door, there were foreigners living as paying guests, both in North Waziristan and South Waziristan. On one of the trips, my host, my friend, promised to take me to his guest, two of them. And then on the next trip, both of them chickened out, said, no, I mean, you don't need to go there, you know. But they were having them for quite some time. So this was, and at that time it was not compulsion. They were welcoming them because they were bringing money. As simple as that. You know? So this is another reality that we should live in. You are right, the majority of Pashtun people live in Fatah. They are like practicing Muslims, but not fundamentalists. And you're also right that it was a wave, because this wave in late 1994, early 95, was influenced by the Afghan Taliban, the rise of the Afghan Taliban in Kandahar. But at that time, of course, our military, our intelligence, they also looked the other way. They did not try to intervene. They did not try to stop the Afghan Taliban from enforcing Sharia in North Waziristan. Actually, this is another incident. That in late 1995, Afghan Taliban started crossing into South and North Waziristan, and also in Bajawar, to have the CD shops, music shops, shut down, saying that it is un-Islamic. And at that time, the political agents didn't bother, neither did the military establishment, to stop them. So this is how this thing started proliferating the society. So even if then the majority was not with them, but the majority was silent, or quietly looking on what was happening. And I'm not saying this, look, you know, I've traveled a lot of Waziristani friends, you know, they at times mostly disagree with me, but I've seen, I myself am, for you, I'm maybe a half Pashtun, you know, but I've been through this. And yeah, I think that's the agreements, of course. Just, I think the talk is now beyond the agreements. The contract basically should mean the constitution of Pakistan. That should be the guiding document for any action, any act that is committed on the land, soil of Pakistan. So this is what we should all be demanding, that the law of the land, the constitution, should be applied equally to the Fatah as well. Yep.
सर जैसे आपने जिक्र किया कि फाटा, तो ये बताएं कि इंटरनेशनल कम्युनिटी भी फाटा के लोगों को अपनी एक थ्रेट समझ रहा है, तो इंटरनेशनल कम्युनिटी का क्या रोल होना चाहिए फाटा की वहां पे इस तरह के थ्रेट्स को खत्म करने के लिए, या उनको क्या ऐसा अपना प्रोडक्टिव रोल करना चाहिए जिससे वहां बेहतरी?
देखिए, हम यही बात कर रहे हैं थ्रू द प्रिज्म ऑफ फंडामेंटल ह्यूमन राइट्स. वो देखती है हर चीज को रूल ऑफ लॉ के प्रिज्म से, ठीक है. अब बदकिस्मती से चूंकि हम 1979 से 79 से यहाँ पे अफगान सोवियत इन्वेजन हुई, फिर उसका जिहाद शुरू हो गया उसके खिलाफ, फिर 2001 में उसी जिहाद को अनडू करने के लिए, उसके नतायज को अनडू करने के लिए वॉर ऑन टेरर शुरू हो गई. अब उसका नतीजा ये हुआ कि ये इलाका मजीद निगलेक्ट होता गया. अब बदकिस्मती है कि पाकिस्तान के अंदर उसके बावजूद कोई मूवमेंट नहीं शुरू हुई कि किस तरीके से हम इन इलाकों को मेन स्ट्रीम करें, ताकि मिलिटेंट्स के पास जो जवाब है कि जी ये तो नो गो टेरिटरी है, हमारा कॉन्ट्रैक्ट आपके साथ ये है कि आप इस इलाके में नहीं आ सकते हैं, ताकि उसको खत्म करें और इसको बाकायदा हम कोई मॉनिटरिंग, कोई जो एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर होता है इसको वहां पर एक्सटेंड करें. वो हमने नहीं किया. नतीजा उसका क्या निकला कि 2006-07 के बाद से गैर मुल्की जो तंजीमें हैं उन्होंने काम शुरू किया कि ह्यूमन राइट्स के हवाले से वो ज्यादा जोरदार वो मुहिम शुरू हो गई. फिर उसमें उन्होंने फाटा को भी शामिल किया. अब जो नेशनल डेमोक्रेटिक इंस्टीट्यूट है अमेरिकन एनडीआई है, उन्होंने एक बहुत बड़ी कैंपेन चलाई थी. ये जो टीवी प्रोग्राम हमने किए, 10 हमने एक्सप्रेस पे किए, 10 पीटीवी पे किए और फिर 10 रेडियो प्रोग्राम हमने किए, वो सारा उनकी मदद से हुआ. और बड़ी शर्म की बात थी कि हमारे अपने लोग रिफॉर्म नहीं कर रहे, और जो सदर साहब ने जो काम किया 2011 में जो रिफॉर्म्स थी वो भी एनजीओ ड्रिवन थी, सिविल सोसाइटी ड्रिवन थी. ये नहीं कि हमारे सियासतदान जो पार्लियामेंट में बैठे हुए हैं या हमारी आर्मी जो है इन्होंने अपने पे ही वो काम किया. नो, इट वॉज द बॉटम ऑफ प्रेशर with the support of the civil society here and with the external resources, मतलब बाहर के माली वसाइल उसके उसमें इस्तेमाल हुए. तो जो बैन अक्वामी बरादरी का अब एक यही रोल हो सकता है कि जो मकामी सिविल सोसाइटी है, मकामी जो लोग हैं जो बराह रास्त मुतासर हो रहे हैं, उन सबको मिल मिला के एडवोकेसी करें, सेमिनार्स करें, टीवी पे चले जाएं, टीवी प्रोग्राम कर लें, आर्टिकल्स लिख लें. इसके अलावा तो बैन अक्वामी बरादरी कुछ नहीं कर सकती, क्योंकि बैन अक्वामी बरादरी जब उधर स्टेप इन करती है तो जाहिर है फाटा में तो मैं एज ए नॉन फाटा पर्सन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनली अंडर द एफसीआर मैं वहां पे नहीं जा सकता. मैं पॉलिटिकल एजेंट से पूछ के जाता हूं, एम आई राइट? ऐसे ही है ना? तो बाहर वालों को तो छोड़ दें. उन्होंने फिर क्या किया, जो डॉक्टर शकील अफरीदी ने जो काम किया कि वो था फाटा सेक्रेटेरिएट का मुलाजिम, तनख्वाह उधर से ले रहा था और काम वो सीआईए के लिए कर रहा था, वो फिर इन चीजों पे मजबूर होते हैं. तो लिहाजा बेहतर ही होता है कि जहां पे अगर आग है आग को आप खुद बुझाएं, और आग है वहां पे डिसकंटेंट की, आग है वहां पे हुकूक इंसानी की और रूल ऑफ लॉ की, तो वो हमने नहीं बुझाने की कोशिश की. बाहर वाले लोग आते हैं उसमें फिर क्या होता है कि वो एजेंडाज फिर एनमेश हो जाते हैं कि हम वाकईतन चाहते हैं कि फाटा में रिफॉर्म आए, लेकिन उसके लिए जो दूसरे बाहर के लोग हैं वहां भी कोई लोग चाहते हैं जो रूल बेस्ड लॉ, ह्यूमन राइट्स लॉ बेस्ड ऑर्गेनाइजेशन हैं कि यहाँ पे हुकूक इंसानी इनको मिले. उसमें फिर दूसरे लोग भी आ जाते हैं जिस तरह जो फिर डॉक्टर शकील अफरीदी जैसे लोगों को इंस्ट्रूमेंट के तौर पर इस्तेमाल करते हैं. सो ये बदकिस्मती है कि पाकिस्तान के अंदर ये प्रेशर, पार्लियामेंट के अंदर से ये प्रेशर नहीं आया, ये प्रेशर बाहर से आया. और मैं आपको एक बात बताऊं कि जो 2005 के आखिर में प्रेसिडेंट मुशर्रफ ने एक मीटिंग बुलाई, उसमें पूरा फाटा सेक्रेटेरिएट के नुमाइंदे थे. फाटा सेक्रेटेरिएट बेसिकली गवर्नर के बिहाफ पे पूरे फाटा को गवर्न करता है और उसका एक इंचार्ज होता है, एडिशनल चीफ सेक्रेटरी उसको कहते हैं. तो वो फाटा सेक्रेटेरिएट की मीटिंग बुलाई, फिर उन्होंने कुछ पोलिटिकल एजेंट्स को सबको बुलाया, और उस मीटिंग का मकसद ये था कि हम फाटा को मेनस्ट्रीम कैसे कर सकते हैं. दो दिन वो मीटिंग हुई, सबने अपने अपने प्रेजेंटेशन कहा जी बड़ी अच्छी बात है, बड़े नेक इरादे हैं। अब दो दिन के आखिर में फिर सोचा कि हम किस नतीजे पर पहुंचे हैं, नतीजा कोई नहीं था। अगर चले जी अब अगली मीटिंग में फिर करेंगे, बहुत बहुत बड़ी एक्सरसाइज थी वो। उस मीटिंग में उन्होंने यही फिर कहा आखिर में आके कि जी वो ये भी हो सकता है ये भी हो सकता है, लेकिन अभी ना हालात ठीक नहीं है। आर्मी ने अपने हिसाब से आर्ग्यूमेंट्स दिए उसमें, पॉलिटिकल एजेंट्स चूंकि वो उसके बेनिफिशरीज हैं उस सिस्टम के, उसमें ऑडिट नहीं है, तो जो खैबर एजेंसी का पॉलिटिकल एजेंट है सबसे अमीर वो होता है क्योंकि ट्रांजिट ट्रेड वहां से होती है ना, सबसे अमीर वो है। 1995 में कहा जाता था कि 40-50 लाख महाना उसकी आमदनी है, आजकल वो करोड़ों में है। इसी तरह जो मोहम्मद जो नॉर्थ वजीरिस्तान है इसका बॉर्डर भी अच्छा ल्यूक्रेटिव था क्योंकि निस्बतन वो करीब है। सो उनके अपने स्टेक्स थे पूरे जो फाटा सेक्रेटेरिएट है, जो ब्यूरोक्रेसी है ना। मुझे जो अभी इस वक्त चीफ सेक्रेटरी हैं केपीके के, अमजद अली खान, ही वॉज अ पोलिटिकल एजेंट ऑफ खैबर एजेंसी इन 1996 जनवरी। ही टोल्ड मी के आई वेंट टू इंटरव्यू हिम एंड ही सेड यू नो दिस सीट इज वेरी पावरफुल, everybody wants this. I of course didn't ask why everybody wants it, but this meant there's a lot of money in it. So it was this vested interest, the bureaucracy, the maliks and the military, particularly the intelligence, they have been, you know, working against any reforms. That's why that meeting, that long meeting, very big meeting in 2005 December ended without any conclusion. And then एक और हमारा तजुर्बा ये हुआ कि जब हम टीवी प्रोग्राम कर रहे थे, ये 20 प्रोग्राम जो हमने किए, इसमें जब हम प्रोग्राम कंक्लूड करते थे उस दौरान ही पता चल जाता था कि कौन रिफॉर्म के हक में और कौन खिलाफ है। हमने स्टूडेंट्स भी बुलाए होते थे, 6-7-8 स्टूडेंट्स भी बैठे होते थे, सिविल सोसाइटी के लोग भी बैठे हैं। तो जो ज्यादातर जो MNAs थे और सेनेटर्स, वो कहते नहीं नहीं पहले सिक्योरिटी आए, पहले पीस आए, तो उसके बाद आप रिफॉर्म की बात करें। ये तो आप अपने नतीजे पे, अपने इस नतीजे पे क्यों पहुंच गए कि लोग रिफॉर्म चाहते हैं, लोग इससे फातमा चाहते हैं। सो वो जो वेस्टेड इंटरेस्ट है पाकिस्तान के अंदर वो इतना मजबूत है कि उसको जड़ से उखाड़ना बड़ा मुश्किल है। और वो एक ही तरीका है उसके लिए कि पार्लियामेंटेरियंस के साथ जो भी आते हैं उनके एडवोकेसी की जाए, पब्लिक कंसल्टेशन जहां जहां मुमकिन हो हर एक को ये बात करनी चाहिए, सिर्फ उसी जरिए ये मामला कहीं आगे जा सकता है। आप कुछ पूछ रहे थे।
अकॉर्डिंग टू आर्टिकल 247 प्रेसिडेंट हैज अथॉरिटी ओवर फाटा, व्हाइल आर्टिकल 246 सेज दैट फाटा इज अ पार्ट ऑफ पाकिस्तान। सो इजंट इट द कॉन्ट्रडिक्शन विद इन द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन?
इट इज ऑफ कोर्स।
So how
can we talk about
reforms if constitution itself, Pakistan constitution, has the contradictions about Fatah issues?
Yeah, because it's the beneficiaries that I was talking about. So they have obstructed, they have stonewalled any movement towards reform because they are direct beneficiaries. They make a lot of money. So the political agents share that money as well. So that's what we are talking about, that the forget about because Article 246 declares it as Pakistan's territory, but the law of the land doesn't apply to it. The Supreme Court doesn't have any jurisdiction there. The Peshawar High Court doesn't have a jurisdiction there. That's what we are talking about, that this Article 247 may be abolished or replaced with the Parliament. That the Parliament has all the authority to decide on Fatah. Only then can we move forward. Sorry.
One more question. That then how the establishment of military force can be justified in Fatah if Fatah is not governed by the Constitution of Pakistan? Because military force are going to establish through the amendments in the Constitution of Pakistan. So how it can be justified?
Yeah, it's not justifiable. And there are many things which are not justifiable. Many things that Pakistan government and the military have done in the past 3-4 decades, 5 decades. But right now, I think the pressure must be on for reform, for revolution.
the military establishment has always justified its action by saying that the situation demanded so. The way things have developed in Fatah, of course, this was very threatening, very alarming for everybody. The army had to move in. Like you remember, we had a peace deal in September 2006 in North Waziristan, but nobody respected that, neither the military nor the tribes, because the tribes kept sheltering and hosting foreign militants from Al-Qaeda, from Islamic Movement of Uzbekistan. So they basically were continuously breaching that agreement. And they, the peace agreement had basically required of the military to pull back, remove its checkposts. Some of the checkposts removed, but some not. But the issue was that the tribes themselves kept violating those people who were instrumental, the big leaders inside that area. They kept violating. For instance, Hafiz Gul Bahadur was a big friend of the military establishment. That's fine. You know, the military did a lot of things with the support of Hafiz Gul Bahadur. But Hafiz Gul Bahadur was providing shelter to Al-Qaeda, to the Haqqani Network people, to the IMU. And he was providing shelter even to the Tehrik-e-Taliban Pakistan people when they ran from South Waziristan. So now I think since June, when they started this Operation Zarbeaz, we're just, the Hafiz Gul Bahadur has been on the run, probably somewhere in the mountains or somewhere in Afghanistan. And the sense we get from the military is that they are now looking for him, because now they want to just divorce that old policy of not touching somebody who is helpful for state actions. So now I'm just hoping, as a Pakistani, that they really mean this when they say we will hunt down terrorists indiscriminately. In sab ke khilaf bila imtiaz karwai hogi. To umeed ye karni chahiye ki waqaiatan jo hukumat aur army keh rahi hai, us pe ek amal bhi kiya jayega. So Noor sir, aap kuch pooch rahe
hain. My question is a sort of comment come question. Initially, it was evident by that documentary that some of the indicators about Fatah were extremely pathetic, and the literacy rate, the health and unemployment and poverty indicators were so much alarming. So if we see FCR on one side, we have discussed the powers of political agents, so suppressive and repressive for the people, without having any fundamental rights for the people of Fatah. So on one side, the indicators are very pathetic and alarming. And on the other side, if you see that the connection, that on one side, the indicators are this for the past 60 or 70 years, and on the other side, the suppression of the political agent by the federal structure as well. So do you not see that this suppression is very much required for these low, pathetic, alarming indicators as well? There is a connection between the two. And that's why the state or the government or the governments, they deliberately wanted those alarming indicators for their own suppression and repression of the people and negligible fundamental rights. As you mentioned earlier, that from this documentary I wanted to portray that most of the Fatah people, they are unaware of the FCR and the laws in the FCR. So if the indicators are very much low, how can they come to know about the rights and all the rights that they are violated, or the suppression by the state or by the agencies? So you see that if the indicators are not, they are not developed, if they are not given the attention, only then we can blame the people of Fatah for all this. So there is a strong connection of that. The second important question is regarding the FCR, that mostly we have talked about the abolition of the FCR. or most of us want the abolition of the FCR. But in which procedure will it be abolished? Like it will be like a phased process starting from one agency, or it will be, if we want to take a start for the abolition of FCR, so will it be abruptly a change from the FCR into the constitution in the whole FATA region, or will it be a phased process? What you suggest as an expert? I want your opinion. Because we talk about the abolition, but we do not have that solution or procedure that we can give a suggestion. So kindly.
Intentionally, in logon ko jaan boojh ke maalumaat se ilm se mehroom rakha gaya hai. Ab uska ye kehna ke this is just meant to perpetrate suppression. I may not agree with that, but the keeping people ignorant and deprived of fundamental rights itself is a suppression, an oppression. So I look at it more from the human rights perspective, that it's a criminal neglect, and the way FATA people have been handled. And of course, as we discussed, there's the vested interest, whether it's the military or the bureaucracy, they have been stonewalling this. So no disagreement on that, that this has been used as a, in your words, you know, this is a tool of suppression. But what has gone missing in this entire discourse is they didn't realize all these vested interests. That you cannot have a so-called strategic backyard which itself is on fire. How do you insulate your own self from such a volatile, inflamed region? So this has gone lost, I think. Maybe they realize it now. Because this trouble is kept troubling, you know, from Afghanistan to Fatah to Punjab. It will keep moving. The way, you know, this is very infectious, this militancy and religious radicalization. As for the abolition or the FCR, look, you know, there have been two approaches suggested for that. One was an incremental change, that first, they introduced this Political Parties Act and allowed elections on adult franchise in 1997. Yeah, was that 1997, I think, for the first time?
96.
What, the November 96, yeah, the first election. And now, I think Political Parties Act also was like in the last elections. Now, people can contest elections, but not on party basis. Was it party basis?
It was party basis.
Party basis.
One man, one vote, and what these activities were allowed to vote here in FATA.
Exactly.
Parties were not allowed to campaign or to...
campaigning was not, that was probably because of the security reasons.
Yeah.
But they could. So now what is being demanded is extension of the local government. That this will be another way of mainstreaming FATA and create a constituency for empowerment for local people. Now, the other proposition was to abolish it and turn it into a province. I've met so many people from FATA, from KP, nobody agrees, there is no consensus on this. So somehow it has to be, it will take a very, very strong political will at the center to use these Maliks and the members of parliament as vehicles for this change. They put them together in one room, 200, 300, 400 people, make them agree to something, and then enforce it through a presidential ordinance. Whether they want a separate province, I don't think it will be feasible. Because it's so scattered. Maybe I personally think they should be integrated into the KP province, and then given a lot of development resources. And that would mean basically abolish FATA, integrate it into KP, and then back it up with financial support, with administrative support. So this is such a tricky thing. because of their vested interests. So this is what we've been discussing a lot. You know, we never came to a consensus. And however, this thing about one room, under one roof, yes, like convention center, you know, they can collect 400-500 people and then make them agree to something. All leading lights of Fatah. Without that, it is not going to come. Because if the Prime Minister, the President, or the federal government decides, takes a decision, issues an ordinance, the issue will be, will the KP parliamentarians and the Fatah, leading Fatah people, accept it? So the best thing is to generate a consensus on this, with the support of a few hundred people, and then enforce it. As of now, it looks very difficult. Sorry, aap kuch puch rahi thi?
First of all, we need to move forward from the stage of this PowerPoint presentation onto the actual implementation or the application of whatever law that we are proposing. And secondly, I believe that a multi-pronged approach would be required here. I mean, along with the reformation of law and order, I think we require socio-economic upgradation of the people as well. I mean, without that, just proposing the law or something like that would not actually make much of a difference. Thirdly, you mentioned something that the contribution of the Pakistan Army in these areas is socially zero. I personally believe that the army should be just confined to the role of defense purposes only, and although we've been hearing from the army that they've been changing hearts and minds of the people over there in the operational areas, etc., that they've been involved in de-radicalizing the youth, etc., who have been indoctrinated. Don't you think that is something that again the state machinery should be, you know, focusing? And that we should not involve the army, first of all, even if they are involved in such a activity, then we would be the ones to, you know, not like the idea of them being involved in any other, you know, aspect other than defense.
Chief, yeah, you're right. Whatever funding is going into Fatah is routed through the political agent, and political agent has no accountability. So much of the funds allocated or disbursed for Fatah go into individual pockets. That's why there's this demand for local government that at least some mechanism could be put in place where local government will be with FPA. Otherwise, there is no audit of the fund that the political agent sits on. जिसकी वजह से इसीलिए यही लोग हैं जो कि अपोज भी करते हैं रिफॉर्म को क्योंकि इमेजिन द सेम पॉलिटिकल एजेंट राइजेस इन द हायरार्की वो ग्रेड 18 19 20 और वो एक मौके पे आता है वो फिर केपी का चीफ सेक्रेटरी बन जाता है एडिशनल चीफ सेक्रेटरी हो जाता है सो दे कीप बेनिफिटिंग फ्रॉम दैट और माइंडसेट उनका वही होता है लिहाजा दे आर यूजुअली नॉट फॉर रिफॉर्म बातें तो बहुत हो सकती हैं इस पर बाकी सोशियो इकोनॉमिक अपलिफ्ट कैन कम ओनली व्हेन यू एम्पावर द पीपल लीगली एडमिनिस्ट्रेटिवली एंड फाइनेंशियली दैट विल बी पॉसिबल ओनली वंस आवर पार्लियामेंट हैज टेकन अ डिसीजन सेकेंडली ऑफ कोर्स सिविल मिलिट्री दिस डिवाइड और दिस स्टिफ बिटवीन द सिविलियन एंड मिलिट्री द डी रेडिकलाइजेशन प्रोग्राम्स वर the immediate consequence of the SWAT operation. Ab usme, ideally, you're right, civilians should have taken the lead. It's very painful, actually, that now the Sabamun was the first de-radicalization center set up in Malakaran Dargai sometime in early 2010. Civilian government at that time didn't care to take charge of that. And then the military set up another one, Nashal, somewhere near South Waziristan, and it was still the military running it. Even now, this government, it has an entirely different focus. So the military at times is doing things which we should be doing as civilians. De-radicalization or legislation is not the job of the military. As you say, their job is just defense, security. But very unfortunately, I must say, even the amendments to the Anti-Terrorist Act in 2013 were done on the pressure of the military. The civilian government did not want to do it. I'm a witness to that. They wanted to add something like new provisions to protect the judges and to allow the intercepts of the telephone to be used as evidence, and there are different things. So the army had those amendments drafted by a private lawyer, and then they presented it to the law minister, said that, look, you know, because you haven't been doing this, here you go, now that the government is now coming to an end, can you please do this? Because we need this to prosecute people, to go after them. So it was the Anti-Terrorist Act 2013, amended one, came sometime in January or February. So the responsibility is with those who claim to be the public representatives. And they're sitting in the parliament. They're not exercising their right. They're not taking responsibility. They're not taking tough decisions. With the result that the military is still dealing with de-radicalization centers. It should not be. They outsourced apparently this job to a private NGO, to an NGO, but the control remains very much with the military. And I think this is a civilian's failure, that they want to enjoy power, don't want to exercise it. So that's why we're in this mess. And the latest example is military courts. The military courts, we could have given the same powers to a civilian court. Could have created special courts. And we could have gotten like-minded judges, have nominated through the Supreme Judicial Council, given them the same powers, provided them same protection, and they would have started prosecuting or at least conducting a trial. But here, the politicians don't want to take responsibility. They don't want to be seen as the bad guys. So they have outsourced even the judiciary, basically, to the military. It was 2/3 majority, right? In the National Assembly, the 2/3 majority, they're handing over judiciary, the executive, the judicial power, also to the military. What could be more ironical than this? I've had several discussions with these politicians. I said, you can create same courts under the civilian judiciary with the same power, same protection. You know, People's Party has its like-minded people in the judiciary, PMLN, has like-minded judges because they have appointed them. You know, TPP had appointed its own judges between 2008-2013. This government has also picked up a lot of people. They are like-minded, put them in good positions. Why can't you do this? You know, there are hundreds of lawyers who you can appoint as senior lawyers who have political affiliations, who can be put as judges and given the same protection. So, sorry. I'm very passionate about it. So, but coming back to your original question, we can do this if we want. And this is a big task facing the parliament. Sorry, aapko poochhe.
What do you think that now our establishment and mainstream political parties, do they have any sympathy for reforms in current scenario?
Yes. Simple answer. Bachche, aapko pooch rahe the?
War on terror. The crime rate of Fatah used to be 100 times better than than in any part of the settled area of Pakistan. And there is a prevailed perception, I would rather say it's established fact, that people in Fatah doesn't really want the judicial system of Pakistan to be implemented in their region, because it's so paralyzed and it's so ineffective. They want their gender and panchayat system to be reformed.
There's a misnomer about it, whether they want. The same chief secretary I was talking about, Amjad Ali Khan, जो हम बात कर रहे थे ना कि वेस्टेड इंटरेस्ट की जो बात थी, जब हम इनके साथ ट्रैवल कर रहे थे फॉर द डॉक्यूमेंट्री, इन्होंने ये किया कि स्केयरक्रो, are you familiar with this terminology, scarecrow, वो खेतों में खड़ा करते थे काला कपड़ा बांध के कौवे ना आए तो या चिड़िया ना आए, तो वो स्केयरक्रो होता है. तो उन्होंने जितनी एस्टेब्लिशमेंट है, ब्यूरोक्रेसी है फाटा की, उन्होंने इसको पाकिस्तानी जुडिशल सिस्टम को या लीगल सिस्टम को एक स्केयर क्रो के तौर पे इस्तेमाल किया है हमेशा. तो हम दो तीन जर्गों में गए उनके साथ ही. अब वो हर जर्गे में लामहाला ये होता था कि वो उठ के कह रहे हैं कि जी हमें FCR से निजात दिलाएं, हमें इंसाफ चाहिए. बिलीव मी, दिस इज हाउ लाइक 90% people would say, we want justice, we want to get rid of this FCR. आखिर में political agents आप तकरीर करते थे, और ये तकरीर मैंने कई दफा सुनी है, तो वजीरिस्तान में भी सुनी और बाजौर में भी सुनी. तो वो कहते हैं हाँ बड़ी अच्छी बात है, बड़ी खुशी हुई आप डिमांड कर रहे हैं तब्दील होना चाहिए. तो कहते हैं बट यू नो क्या आप चाहते हैं कि जो करप्ट निजाम है पुलिस का पाकिस्तान का वो आपके घरों तक पहुंचे, आपकी चादर चार दीवारी का तकलीफ पमाल हो? आप चाहते हैं कि पुलिस वाला आके आपके दरवाजा खटखटाए, आपकी घरों की इज्जत खराब हो उसमें? अगर आप वो चाहते हैं तो मैं फिर गौर को कह देता हूं. सो दिस इज हाउ दे आर्ग्यूड अगेंस्ट द पाकिस्तान लीगल जस्टिस सिस्टम. उसमें खराबियां तो बहुत है बिलाशुबा, लेकिन क्या उसका ये मतलब है कि आप उन लोगों को अपने हालात के मुताबिक रहने दें? क्योंकि फाटा क्राइम अगर वहां पे बढ़ा है, क्राइम कौन सा बढ़ा है? वो सारा मिलिटेंसी रिलेटेड है. जितना यहां का जुराइम पेशा लोग होते थे, जितनी अगवाशुदा गाड़ियां थी, वो सारी फाटा में जाती थी, रिपोर्ट नहीं होती थी. अभी काफी कुछ रिपोर्ट हो जाता है. ठीक है, आप ये नहीं कर सकते कि कहते हैं कि हम पाकिस्तानी हैं, हम पासपोर्ट हमें चाहिए, दुबई जाना है, लंदन जाना है, लेकिन आपके घर में एक कानून शिकन बंदा, एक कातिल, कोई मिलिटेंट है, टेररिस्ट है, वो ठहरा हुआ है कि जी हमारा तो ये रिवाज है FCR के तहत, तो हम पनाह दे सकते हैं, रिवाज के तहत हम ये कर सकते हैं, पख्तून वाले की ये डिमांड है. यू कांट हैव इट बोथ वेज, आइदर यू रिमेन अ पश्तून पख्तून वाली पे जाए, या फिर पाकिस्तान का आईन या कानून जो है वो कबूल करें. ठीक है, तो उसमें एक्चुअली काफी सारी इंफॉर्मेशन की अवेयरनेस की जरूरत है, इसके लिए कई सेशंस चाहिए. लेकिन हम, मैं दूर से अगर आप बैठ के, क्योंकि मैं खुद फाटा से हूं नहीं, लेकिन चूंकि रिपोर्टिंग हम करते रहे, लिहाजा आई हैव अ फेयरली गुड आइडिया, स्टिल नॉट वेरी गुड बट फेयरली गुड आइडिया हाउ इट वर्क्स, लोग आर्ग्यूमेंट्स क्या देते हैं. सो उसका लोबे लबाब अलबत्ता यह है कि वी मस्ट प्रेस फॉर इक्वल राइट्स टू एवरी सिटीजन. उसी कॉन्टेक्स्ट में मेरा ख्याल है कि फाटा के लिए शायद कुछ उम्मीद पैदा हो गई. आप कुछ पूछ रहे थे, लेट्स मेक इट द लास्ट क्वेश्चन.
आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर ताहिर अमीन इफ ही वॉन्ट्स टू आस्क एनीथिंग और कॉमेंट.
आपके बाद
मेरा थोड़ा बताएं कि आईपीसी सिस्टम किस तरह सफर कर रहे हैं. दूसरा, जब ये जरबे अजब स्टार्ट नहीं हुआ था तो सिंह गवर्नमेंट ने पहले से कह दिया कि जितने भी आईडीपीस होंगे हैं, जो भी हैं, वो इधर नहीं आएंगे. एंट्री और एग्जिट पॉइंट पे जो है, ये यहाँ पे आप पुलिस वगैरह बढ़ा दे, दे आर नॉट सपोज टू एंटर इन आर एरिया. तो इसके क्या इम्प्लीकेशन है इन साइड ऑफ फेडरल स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ पाकिस्तान, कि एक इलाका दूसरे इलाके से कह रहा है कि माइग्रेशन फ्रॉम वन कॉन्फ्लिक्ट जोन इट्स नॉट अलाउड हियर. सो इसके क्या इम्प्लीकेशन है फॉर फेडरल स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ पाकिस्तान?
ठीक है, ये तो आप, दीज आर सच डिमांड्स और सच विशेज आर ऑल ड्रिवन बाय लोकल पॉलिटिक्स. उसमें फेडरलिज्म बेसिकली, या इफ इट रिलेट्स टू फेडरल,
federalism, you know, demands or requires socio-economic political equality, equal rights. वो अगर नहीं है हमारे सोसाइटी तो बहुत ही इस वक्त इंतजार का शिकार है ना. हर बंदा अपने अपने कॉन्टेक्स्ट में अपने अपने ककून में रह रहे. फॉर इंस्टेंस शहबाज शरीफ ऑल्सो 2 years ago said कि तालिबान पंजाब को स्पेयर कर दें, यहां ना आए, हमारा हमने क्या बिगाड़ा हुआ उनका. तो जब सबसे बड़े सूबे के चीफ मिनिस्टर ने ये कहा कह दिया तो वो जो सिंध में बैठे हुए हैं उनको तो पता भी नहीं होता वो क्या कह रहे हैं. वो कहते हैं वो हालत भंग में होते हैं. तो वो उन्होंने अगर कह दिया तो डोंट टेक हिम सीरियसली. हाउएवर दैट हैज एन इम्प्लीकेशन फॉर द फेडरेशन, फॉर द स्पिरिट ऑफ फेडरेशन. द स्पिरिट ऑफ फेडरेशन डिमांड्स इक्वल जस्टिस, कंसिडरेशन, सिंपथी, एम्पथी फॉर अदर ऑल फेडरेटिंग यूनिट्स. Whereas the Pakistani politics currently is a lot more parochial, provincial. Everybody, every party is fighting for its own constituency. For PPP, it's a sin. For Nawaz League, it's Punjab. So they will keep saying these things which are not, we do not reflect the regard for federalism, right? Now, IDPs, that's a sorry story. The way they were evacuated, basically it was a repeat of what happened in Swat. And within a couple of days, they had to just leave their homes. Because we were following those events in those days, so they decided to have an operation. I think the army had decided on the 25th of April. Then they went into consultations with the civilian government. They decided on the 6th, and then people were asked to leave. The same thing happened here. Here they had some advance notice, but yes, that also reflects the absence of administrative legal structures, or the downside of the absence of administrative legal structures in Fatah. That according to 1998, wahan ki abadi 3.5 million, to kuch kehte 5 million hai. Theek hai? Nobody had an idea. Now, just 3 sub-districts from North Waziristan, unki jab sari verification wagaira bhi ho gayi, the numbers of just that small agency is now at least 800, nearly a million people. Jabki pehle andaze ke mutabik wo hardly 3 lakh log the, 1998 ke mutabik. So, because we don't have a functional state system there, so we also couldn't figure out. And that's why initially there was a lot of duplication as well. You know, everybody rushed to Koha, to Banu, for getting him or herself protected. So yes, initially they were taken care of, but then there were also a lot of stories where people who were living here in Islamabad, people who were living in Rawalpindi, in Peshawar, they simply rushed to Banu for rations because it was free, you know. 100 kg wheat flour and sugar. So that was the sad side of the story. But generally, they have been suffering. Now the big dilemma facing them is, why should they go back? Where to? Because it's still governed by the FCR. That is a huge dilemma, that when they go back, they will be exposed to the same environment. However, this may be also a blessing, that now that the majority of people is registered, they are polio vaccinated. So maybe on this side, maybe a little fortunate. But otherwise, you know what happens to the people. Even living in Rawalpindi or in the rural areas, what happens to them administratively? Can the state provide education to everybody? Can the state provide health cover to everybody? No, it's a very bad government hospitals, government schools. They're in a shambles. So now magnify that to what is happening to the IDPs. Very simple. Sorry.
जब भी फाटा की बात होती है, invariably यही factors जो आपने गिनाए कि colonial heritage है, एक FCR है, underdevelopment है, लिटरेसी रेट बड़ा लो है, हेल्थ फैसिलिटीज नहीं है, जस्टिस नहीं है वगैरह, लेकिन आपने चूंकि बहुत अरसा इसको स्टडी किया है, मैं ये जानना चाहूंगा कि चीजें तो चल ही रही थी 60 साल से या 67 साल से, लेकिन ट्रिगर क्या था मिलिटेंसी का कि जिसकी वजह से पूरा एक रीजन जो है वो इन सम सेंस कैंसरस हो गया। मेरी टेंटेटिव ऑब्जर्वेशन एंड मैं चाहूंगा आप अपना फीडबैक दें काइंडली, मेरा ये ख्याल है कि पाकिस्तानी स्टेट की जो अफगान पॉलिसी थी वो इतनी एम्बिगुअस और इतनी कंट्राडिक्टरी थी कि उसके लॉन्ग टर्म कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस सोचे ही नहीं गए। जब तालिबान को सपोर्ट किया गया फॉर अ वेरी शॉर्ट टर्म्स गेनिंग स्ट्रेटेजिक डेप्थ इन अफगानिस्तान, उसका नतीजा ये हुआ कि तालिबान का वो बैकलैश जो है वो आपका अमेरिकन इंटरवेंशन के बाद वो सारा का सारा आपके फाटा में सरायत कर दिया। तो ये स्टेट जो है उसकी पॉलिसी ऐसे लगता है कि जैसे एक बहुत इमीडिएट ट्रिगर था, और अफगान पॉलिसी हमारी जो है जब तक वो उसके ऊपर कोई रिव्यू नहीं होगा, रीथिंकिंग नहीं होगी, तो उस वक्त तक हम चाहे इंटरनल फैक्टर्स को या इंटरनल रिफॉर्म्स को कितना एम्फेसाइज कर लें, लेकिन हकीकत यह है कि फाटा में अमन कायम नहीं हो सकता जब तक कि अफगानिस्तान से हमारा वो जो सारा लिंक है वो सही नहीं होता और हमारी पॉलिसी जो है वो चेंज नहीं होती टुवर्ड्स अफगानिस्तान। एक तो मेरी ये ऑब्जर्वेशन है। दूसरा ये कि क्या आपके ख्याल में ऑपरेशन दरबे अजब के बाद क्या सारे हमारे स्टेक होल्डर्स जो हैं उन्होंने उनमें कोई रियल आपको चेंज ऑफ हार्ट नजर आता है, या इसी तरह से कंटिन्यूटी जारी रहेगी कि बजाहिर आप लिप सर्विस देते हैं लेकिन एक्चुअली यू कंटिन्यू द सेम पॉलिसी? क्योंकि अफगानिस्तान में पाकिस्तान की पॉलिसी अभी तक कोई मैं उसमें कोई बड़ी फंडामेंटल शिफ्ट नहीं देख रहा, यानी आपके जो स्ट्रेटेजिक एसेट्स हैं सो कॉल्ड, अगर इंडिया वहां नए सिरे से बहुत एक्टिवली इन्वॉल्व हो जाता है तो फिर पाकिस्तान जाहिर है अपने एसेट्स और खासतौर पर तालिबान को मोबिलाइज करेगा। तो फ्यूचर आप क्या देखते हैं इंटरनेशनल परस्पेक्टिव में भी कि क्या अफगान सिचुएशन की वजह से देर वुड देर बी ए कंटिन्यूटी ऑफ द सेम अफगान पॉलिसी और चेंज?
बात ये कि यस अफगानिस्तान या जो सोवियत इन्वेजन थी ऑफ अफगानिस्तान इन 1979 दिसंबर, दैट वाज अ प्राइमरी ट्रिगर फॉर इनिशिएशन ऑफ रिलीजन बेस्ड काउंटर अटैक जो हमने किया जिहाद के नाम पे, और उसमें फिर पाकिस्तान जो है तो धंसता चला गया। स्ट्रेटेजिक डेप्थ की जो पॉलिसी थी वो 1976 में उसने जन्म लिया था, जो जुल्फिकार अली भुट्टो साहब के जमाने में, नसीरुल्लाह बाबर साहब, आफ्ताब शेरपाओ और उस कर्नल बोतला असलम बोतला होते थे, ये उनकी एक इख्तरा थी कि हमें यह स्ट्रेटेजिक डेप्थ है अफगानिस्तान, लिहाजा यहां पे हमारे प्रॉक्सीज होने चाहिए। तो ये उस वक्त से शुरू होता है, इट वॉज नॉट अंडर जनरल जियाउल हक, एंड देन जनरल जियाउल हक डीपेंड इट फर्दर, री एनफोर्स इट। अफगान जो जिहाद शुरू हुआ या सोवियत इन्वेजन के खिलाफ जो जंग शुरू हुई वो एक फिर एक बहुत बड़ा उसके लिए ट्रिगर बन गया। हम यहाँ वैसे ही कॉम्प्रोमाइज कर रहे थे जिया साहब, तो उन्होंने कहा कि ठीक है जी, उधर हम जिहाद शुरू करते हैं, इधर हम शरीयत नाफिज करते हैं। तो इट्स रिलेटेड टू दैट, 1979 इज द बेसिकली वाटर शेड फॉर पाकिस्तान एज फार एज रिलीजियस militancy is concerned, because it was a time of Iranian revolution and the Soviet invasion, and the West and Pakistan positioned itself, aligned itself with the West for a response to the Iranian revolution and to the Soviet occupation of Afghanistan. And of course then 9/11 basically heated it up, the same forces, and the undefined, practically undefined character of Fatah provided the space. And Pakistan's, the government policy, the anti-Soviet policy or the jihad policy legitimized the non-state actors operating in Fatah. This means that state or state institutions inadvertently or inadvertently promoted religious radicalization. They looked the other way as the TNSM came into existence, as the Taliban took power in Afghanistan. I spent time also with Afghan Taliban, the way the ISI and the military was interacting with the Afghan Taliban, looking at them as the hope for the strategic depth. And then our own Kashmir policy. Because the assets we had there, or the friends we had there, we diverted them to Kashmir. So this is how it is linked to Afghanistan. That's why I keep saying that most of Pakistan's security-related problems today, they are linked to word K. That is Kashmir and Kabul. They flow from there. That it started with Kabul, and we hooked it up to Kashmir, and look what a mess we are in. Whether it is changing, jo aapne bhi kaha ki kya tabdeel ho gayi hai policy, I personally think maybe the change is around a little bit of change. Why? Jo Pakistan ka duplicitous policy thi ya hai, wo abhi totally exposed ho gayi. Uski utility ki shelf life thi. For the ambiguous policy that you cooperating with the United States and the ISAF, whereas you're protecting your own people or hedging your bets. But that policy has outlived its utility. Because now what you see inside Pakistan is the direct consequence of that duplicitous policy. We cannot have normalized relationship with Afghanistan unless we have normal relations with India. No. India is still treated as the enemy country. So why shouldn't the enemy country take benefit from our troubled neighborhood and inflict more pain on us? If we are doing the same to them in Kashmir. This is so intricately linked. That's why I have been saying that the road to peace and regional development for Pakistan lies through New Delhi. New Delhi has invested there, and New Delhi has invested in the security establishment in Afghanistan. So they have a particular view of Pakistan. India has a particular view of Pakistan. That view goes to Washington. That's why when John Kerry comes here, and he has come here at least 10 times in the last 7 years, every time he says the disruption of terrorist networks that are inimical to Afghanistan, that are inimical to India. So that narrative is now so universalized, sort of. The narrative on Pakistan. Whatever India has done, and India has much bigger say, they have moved on, there's about to possibly become member of the United Nations Security Council. They're in a different league. They have very successfully done what they needed to neutralize Pakistan. I mean, you can always keep saying Pakistan is located in a very strategic location. But that strategic location has become a khanda around our neck. It's a stranglehold. It's a noose around our neck. Kituski vajah se, the military establishment, the civilian ruling elite, they didn't do anything. You were asking about the reform question. That's why they didn't reform themselves. We had all the time, even in the last 14 years, to reform. Nobody went for the reform. It was all just patchwork. Like cosmetic changes, nobody goes to the root cause. And hence, the crisis, the economic crisis, the security crisis we are in. Now, having said that, I think here I should end now. If we do not demonstrably, categorically, divorce the duplicitous policy towards India and towards Afghanistan, this country will have little hope of survival.
this is the conclusion I have reached. Probably some of you may remember, April 1999, Nazim Sethi Sahab, the Fair Times editor, you all know him, he said something in New Delhi at a seminar, something equal to Pakistan is a failed state. As a result of that, he was picked up for 40 days by the ISI or IB, whatever. So he went through an ordeal. Now, today, how do you explain? Can you really deny what he said in 1999? It's not that he said something biblical, but imagine ki puri aadhi qaum jo line mein lagi hai petrol ke piche. KP mein, you know, we get now more gas from KP than we get from Balochistan. But most of homes in KP are cold. They don't get enough gas. There's so no petrol, no gas, because nobody has reformed the system. So if we don't change that policy categorically, then the results are obvious.
Madam Sethi sahab bhi akalmand ho gaye hain, ab wo chidiya ka sahara lete
hain. Yeah, wo dekhen, he's after all, he's an individual, he's part of the ruling elites now. Of course, he will take his positions, covering himself up, you know. But the reality remains the same. The reality has become much, much more bitter 16 years down the lane. Now, this is what people don't realize. So, thank you very much.